So, hello students. Good morning to all. I Deepika Saraswat, your object oriented programming teacher. As students, we have already discussed about the lecture number 1, and in that lecture number 1 we have taken a small look about the subject in a form of object oriented thinking. Now students, in this video I just take a look on the basics of the subject, which is the introduction about the object oriented programming. So if we take some prior look about our previous lecture, so in previous lecture we have take a look about why we need object oriented programming and what can be the basic terminologies or basic contents of the object oriented programming. Now the next, if we move further in this video, I have all the basic terms which are including with the previous terms of the previous lecture and some new terms of object oriented programming with the some extended features of the object oriented programming also. So students, there are some points on which we need to cover up this topic. So as usual, first of all we'll discuss about some prerequisites of this topic, in which I'll tell you about that what are those things that you should known about priorly. Now the next, we'll discuss about some objective of this topic, because whenever we want to study any subject and any topic, first of all we should know about the motive behind this subject or this topic, that why we are studying this. So the objective of any of the subject and any of the topic is very much compulsory. The next term that we'll include here, which is the object oriented programming, some basic terminologies, that term I have taken from the previous lecture, because these are very basic terms which are very much useful in our this lecture also. So I just take previous terms from the previous lecture. Now the important thing that today I'll focus here, which is about the object oriented programming, that what is object oriented programming concepts. Now very important topic that I'll also discuss, which is object oriented programming features, that what are those features on which we need to talk, because if there is any approach, and we can say it's a kind of very much a standard approach, and as previously we have discussed that approach is very much useful to manage some real life and real world problems. It means that approach has very much positive things in it. It means there are number of features also available with this approach. Now at last we'll discuss about some applications areas of object oriented programming, because whenever we going to study any topic, first of all two things that we should cover up here. First of all, what is topic here and why we are going to study it and where it is going to implement. So these are some basic points, and on the basis of these points we'll cover up all these topics of the subject, and at last we'll take a few look about the outcomes, that what we have learned from this topic and what that topic will give to us, and at last we have some references here. So as I have already suggested you that here in our previous lectures, I'm just having a similar reference which is from our book Bala Goswami. So this is very basic and common reference, will be common reference in our all sections, and you should always follow these books. I just always suggest you just follow these books. Now students, if we start with some prerequisites about this topic, so we can see if previously we go, then it means there are some programmable structures, some designing structures, some designing capabilities always should in our minds, which we have discussed from the procedural oriented approach. Because the students, before learning and before understanding about the object oriented approach, we all have very much familiar about the procedure oriented approach. Here we just go from the top to bottom approach for any further discussion or development. So its prerequisites is always should be here that we should know about all the basics of the conditional structures, which are very much fully and correctly using in our in the program. Now next also we should know about the looping structural environments, and next we should be able to understand about the class and the some objects. So this is a very much basics prerequisites about this terminology. Now if we move to the objective of this term, so objective is only one behind the object oriented programming, which is only related with the real world problems, because students, as we have known that in object oriented programming approach, this is used to solve the large and big problem which is related any real world problems. So what is real world problems? Real world problems are those projects on which we can work, and we can give these projects to our society as the output, so that the number of users can work and can use this development. So this is totally related with some real world problems, which are totally related with real time environments also. And the important thing here that this is totally related with reusability concepts, as we have already discussed in previous lectures also. So this is very much emphasis on a single topic, which is reusability concept. So this is very much more emphasized topic here. Now students, these are some basic terminology of this topic, which is related with some objects, methods, some properties or attributes, which is known as some data members, member functions, and the combination of class. So these are some basic four combination by which we complete the approach. Now students, we have some points here which will tell us that what is object oriented programming. So with the help of these points, we'll understand about the term object oriented programming. Because if we talk about object oriented programming paradigm, so we can say it's a kind of very much major, and we can say motivating factor, and that motivating factor which is in the invention of object oriented approach, and that is also used to remove some of the flaws that encountered in the procedural approaches also. So first of all, we here we'll discuss that there are some flaws or some negative points in a procedural oriented approaches. So to solve these flaws, we are using the object oriented approach. And one more thing we can say, that object oriented approach always treats data as a critical elements in the program development, and that never allow the data, the flow of data freely around the system. It means data is always in a form of modules, and we can say data is always bind in a form of class here. It's not similar like the procedural approach. and we can say ties the data that is more closely to the functions. So all the data is tied with the functions and that operate on it, and it's also protect these all things from some modifications also from the outside function, so that another functions cannot do the modification in a particular modules. And one more thing that we have in about the object oriented programming, that is always allow some decomposition of a problem into a number of entities, and these entities called the objects, and that objects builds the data and the functions around these objects. And we can say it's if we talk about any organizations, so the organizations of data and the function in object oriented programming always follow this approach, in which the data and function always bind and communicate with the help of the objects. So students, about after the discussion and the big discussion of the object oriented programming, we just have some we'll just focus on some important points, some striking features we can say of object oriented programming. These are those features which always emphasize when we create any program according to the object oriented programming. So what are those things that we'll always include in our program? First, that we always should be emphasis on data. It's means the object oriented programming, it always emphasis on data rather than the procedure. Obviously, whenever we talk about the procedure oriented programming, it always focus on the procedure, that the data will be flow from top to bottom. But here it's emphasis on the data, that what is the data, what's the data structure, what can be the data members, what can be the member functions. So this focus only on these things. Now next points here, which is the programs are divided into modules. Obviously that we have previously discussed, that there the object oriented approach always allow the decomposition of a problem. So decomposition, it means we have divide our programs into a number of modules. So we can say each and every programs are divided into number of modules, and that is called with the help of an entity which is known as the objects. Now next thing, that it's focus on the data structures. It means whenever it's design any approach, so data structures are always designed such that they categorize the object. So to find out the object, we always need to find out the data structures related to that objects. For example, students, suppose I have a data structure here according to the student's environment. There are so many kinds of data that I can involve in my program related to students. Suppose here a student is a name of class. So I'll have number of properties or attributes of a number of data related with the students, like student's name, roll number, student ID, student grades, marks. There can be so many attributes I can take from the student class. So these all attributes are known as the data structures. And now whenever I want to call these attributes according to its created functions, that we'll discuss next, which is known as the member function, that time I'll use the object here, and object will denote all the data structures here. So I just create an object, either it can be a form of single variable also here, and maybe any single letter also. So with the help of this object, we'll call all these data structures. Now one more thing, that the function is also used here, that is used to operate the data of an objects also. The important things is data is hidden here. Data is hidden, it means that cannot be accessed by external functions. And because each and every function and module are independent to each other. And one more thing, object may communicate with each other because here we are creating a number of functions here. So object may communicate with each other through the number of functions also. Now some new data and functions can be added easily because as we know it's a kind of dynamic approach also. So we can add data and functions easily added whenever it's required. And it always follow the bottom-up approach also in program designing. This is very much important points here to discuss because whenever we create any object-oriented program, so in that program we always keep the main function at the end of the program. It's not like approach procedural oriented. Because in procedural oriented, we always are the habitual to write the void main or int main at the top of the program. But here, whenever we want to call any function with the help of the object, so we always kept the program at the bottom. So this is the basic difference here. Now, students, we'll have some look about the object-oriented programming features also. So there are these are those things and those features which will include in each and every program which will be created in an object-oriented environment. So each and every program will include all these things, and these all are very much important feature of the object-oriented approach. So students, if we call about the first feature of the object-oriented programming, so its name is objects. And so many times we have discussed about the term objects also here. So what is object basically? So we can say it's a kind of runtime entity. Runtime entity, it means that is always run according to the class's environment. And it always works whenever the any kind of need of data structures, it always we can always use with the help of the object. So we can say it's a kind of runtime entities. And if we talk about some example of objects, so any object can be any person, it may be any place, it may be any account number, it may be any data structure, any table of the data, it may be any of the programs that we have to handle, it may be any of the documents, that any of the list. So the things which have its own attributes, which has its own class, these all things are known as objects. So here the object which has its own identity and its own data member and function, it's known as the objects. Now, we always call these objects and we always maintain these objects with the help of the class. So, next we'll discuss about the term classes. What is class here? Class means the set of data structure is the combination of data and its relevant member function. So, in a one line we can say classes is the collection of data member and member function. So you should always keep these two points in your mind, always data member and member functions. Data member, it means the data variables which we always declare in a form of some int, char, float. These all are the data members which we call as attributes. And the member function, it means there are such kinds of functions we always use in object-oriented programming, so that with the help of this function, it denotes us that what kind of task is going to do. So we always call our data with the help of these functions, not the help of this data. So we can say classes, it's which contain number of data and its related code to manipulate on that data. And one more thing we can say, it's an entire set of data and code of an object. And that can be made a user-defined data type with the help of a class. And in fact, if we see that objects that are variables of the class, so once a class has been defined, we can create any number of objects belonging to that class also, and each object is associated with the data of type classes with which they are created. So we can create number of objects in our class also. So we can say the class is a collection of similar kinds of objects also. So if we take a simple example here, so we can say if I take example of class fruit, so there can be its object can be mango, apple, orange, because each of these fruits have its own identity, own attributes. So the things which have its own attributes is known as the objects that we have already discussed. So I have take a class fruit and it's have some objects like mango, apple and orange. So these are the very simple example of classes. Now students, next we'll move to the data abstraction and encapsulation. So in the data abstraction and encapsulation, we'll see about the term that what is first we'll discuss what is data abstraction. So abstract means to hide some things which did not represent the whole things, the whole features, the whole data. So first of all, whenever we want to hide something, whenever we want to abstract something, it means we need to wrap up all these things. So first of all, we'll discuss the word encapsulation here. So what is encapsulation? Encapsulate means to wrapping something, to wrap something, to inhale something. So it's a wrapping up of data and functions into a single unit called class. So whenever we create a class, we always create some data member here and we always create some member functions also here. So whenever we create a data member and member function in a single set of class, this concept is known as encapsulation, because the class is wrapping all these things here. Now, what is the term abstraction here? So the abstraction abstraction means which always refers to the act of representing some essential features. So always we need to work here on the essential features without including the background details or explanations. The abstraction means we did not need to put any kinds of detailed explanation here. We just call about the function. We don't know about that how many kinds of data are put in that function. So this is known as the data abstraction. Now students, one more very important points of object-oriented programming. That point is always comes from the word inheritance, comes from the word reusability, which is known as the inheritance. So we can say it's a kind of process by which object of one class always take the properties of the object of another class. So whenever we create number of classes in our single program, each and every object can inherit the property from one to another. So this concept is known as inheritance, and the use of this property always comes in a reusability. Now students, an important term which is the polymorphism. Polymorphism, if we take a short description about it, it means there are many possibilities. It means if we do the single task with a we do the multiple task with a single name here. So whenever we want to create any kind of function, any kind of operations, so we can create we can keep the single name of a function, and we can do the number of different tasks according to that function. So that term is known as polymorphism. Now another important term which is known as dynamic binding. So we'll just have a small look here. Dynamic binding, it means it's also referred to the linking of a procedural call. It means we want to connect some procedural call to the code, that code to be executed in response to the calling. So whenever we want to take some call from the object, this is known as a dynamic binding. and sometimes it's also known as the late binding. Here the code associated with a given procedural call and that is not known until the time of the call at run. And that dynamic binding is associated with polymorphism and inheritance also. So this is about the dynamic binding. One more important feature which always have, which is the message passing. Message passing, it means to provide the message from one class to another. So in message passing, it's an object-oriented programming program that consists of a set of objects and that communicates with each other. So this is the process of programming in an object-oriented language, which have number of steps here whenever we work in message passing environment. So first of all, we need to creating a class, and that class is going to define objects and their behavior. Second, we need to creating some objects from class definitions. Next, we need to establishing some communication among the objects. So message passing is basically a kind of communicating. It's provide a communicating environment among the number of objects which are created in a single program. So students, these were all about some features. So here I'll just have a small look about all these features. But in our next further videos, we'll take one by one look about each and every feature, and we'll take a practical approach also with the each and every features. So the one more important thing that you should know about it, which is the application of object-oriented programming. Because student, whenever we want to run any environment of object-oriented programming, so it's very much a thing that you should know about it, where we are going to do that approach. So in object-oriented programming, first it works in real-time system, those systems which are the time-bound systems. It's also working some simulation and modeling system in scientific environments also. It's also work with object-oriented databases, where the databases is going to create it. It's also work in artificial intelligence, AI, and some expert system which created to maintain the term AI. It also works in neural networks and some parallel programming, parallel computing environments. It also works some decision supports and some office automation system for the documentation. And it's very much important for the other branching also, that is used for the designing purpose also, which have the some tools like CIM, CAM and CAD tools for the designing purpose also. So we can say there are so many approach and so many applications of object-oriented programming. Now students, if we take some conclusion about this session, so we have just take a look on the object-oriented programming. Now next we have take a look about the some points which is related, which will including in object-oriented programming concept. Now we'll include some points, some important features that always exist whenever we create any program. And next we'll move about some application areas of the object-oriented programming. Now we'll come to the outcomes here, that what things we have discussed. So according to that whole videos, we have just talked about the approach which is used to overcome the drawbacks of the procedural oriented programming. So this is very first outcomes here. Now second thing we can also see here, that it also treat that always data as a critical element in a program development, and it does not allow the data to flow freely around the system, because we are not working as a procedural oriented programming. So it's not allow our data to freely around in a system. It always works on a module based programming. So students, after this discussion, in the next video we'll discuss and take the detailed description about the features just like class and objects, and we will take some programmable syntax form that how we'll declare a class, how we'll declare our objects. So with the help of a small program, we'll understand about the term class and objects. So this is about the references. And thank you so much, students. I hope you just enjoy the video and you just learn some outcomes from this video. So just listen the video carefully and just be iterative in the classroom. Thank you so much.